Anybody have any changes to the minutes? Not, they'll stand approved as presented. Next is the public comment session. This is a chance for somebody to get up and speak about something that isn't on the agenda. 5 minutes. Seeing none, I guess we're ready for six.
Mayor and Commissioners, item 6A, the governing body is asked to allow the mayor to proclaim September 11th, 2016 as Day of Service and Remembrance in Garden City, Kansas.
I make a motion to approve the proclamation as presented.
I'll second.
We have a motion and a second to approve the proclamation for Day of Service and Remembrance. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Mayor and Commissioners, item 6B, the governing body is asked to consider and approve a request from Megan Bogus to declare Garden City, Kansas as a Hidden Heroes Supporting City.
I make a motion to approve the proclamation.
Second.
Motion and a second to approve the request for a proclamation for Hidden Heroes Support by the city. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Now the important one.
Mayor and Commissioners, item 6C, the governing body is asked to consider and proclaim September 27th as Butterfly Appreciation Day in Garden City, Kansas. And there wasn't a copy of the proclamation in your packet. I believe Sealand's provided you a copy of that.
I'll make a motion to approve the proclamation as presented.
I'll second.
We have a motion and a second to consider and proclaim September 27, 2016 as Butterfly Appreciation Day. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed? You want to read and take pictures? And
sure.
Okay. Whereas Garden City, Kansas is along the migration route for the monarch butterfly, which is an iconic North American species whose population numbers have declined by more than 90% in the last two decades, due in large part to loss of habitat, and whereas butterflies are a symbol of freedom, beauty, and peace and have taught us about navigation, mimicry, and biodiversity conservation, and have captured our imagination as we watch their metamorphosis from caterpillar to butterfly, and whereas monarch butterflies and other pollinators are crucial to agriculture and agribusiness success and are an indicator species for the health of our environment, and whereas all communities can play a pivotal role in providing crucial habitat, the City of Garden City's Lee Richardson Zoo and Parks Department have responded to this local conservation need with efforts to create butterfly-friendly areas in Garden City and educate others about this future. And whereas we can all make a difference by planting and protecting native milkweed and nectar plants to provide habitat for monarchs and other pollinators. Now, therefore, I, Chris Law, Mayor of the City of Garden City, Kansas, do hereby proclaim September 27, 2016 as Butterfly Appreciation Day in Garden City and join numerous mayors across the country in signing the National Wildlife Federation's Mayor's Monarch Pledge. I also encourage our residents to help make a difference for these butterflies and commend those who are already committed to creating healthy habitat for them. Signed and sealed this 20th day of September 2016, Chris Law, Mayor. Picture?
Do you all want to say anything in addition to what's in the proclamation? You're welcome to.
So the zoo, along with the Parks Department, have worked at increasing monarch-friendly habitat. We have the butterfly garden at the zoo that we're reclaiming, and the Parks Department is working on an area in Forest Park Lake and a few other areas that they've identified. The zoo's also developing additional educational material, which will be shared through various media to tell the story of monarchs and other pollinators. We will be encouraging other gardeners at schools and in gardening groups in the area to increase butterfly-friendly habitat in the area. And of course, milkweed, which is essential to monarchs, has already become a critical part of the local effort through our milkweed seed giveaway, which is part of our Earth Day celebration and has been for a few years now.
Mm-hmm. Oh. All right.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Item 7A, Mayor and Commissioners, Water Resource Manager Jones will present a report regarding water consumption within the city and its city facilities.
Good afternoon, Mayor and Commissioners. Your packet has the attached memorandum to discuss a few issues related to water consumption within the city. First item, the repairs to the big pool have reduced water consumption by 46% this season, saving 14.9 million gallons of water as compared to the 2015 season. The repairs that were completed in the off season, which was the installation of the float valves, is, I guess, what we're identifying as the biggest water saving accomplishment there. Next year, the city will be operating that pool, and so we'll be working probably even more closely with the pool staff on a day-to-day basis regarding water, so hopefully we can continue to improve that number. Non-revenue water consumption, aka free water, usage of water by city departments has increased approximately 13% compared to the same period last year. The majority of the increase in usage is caused by the replacement of an 8-inch meter at Valley View Cemetery by the Water Department staff over the winter. As we have been collecting information on different meters around town over the past few years, the usage at that particular facility didn't seem to correlate with what other facilities were using, and we found that that meter had just aged out, and it had probably happened some time ago. So replacing that meter increase the cemetery's water consumption as recorded by quite a bit, although I don't believe that their actual water use increased over the last year. Our ability to record
under registering.
Yeah, it was under registering. So made a pretty big difference on their part. In other areas of the city, usage remained relatively flat in most departments as compared to 2015. We did notice an increase in consumption at non-pool facilities irrigated by Garden City Recreation Commission, and there was a small increase in consumption within the Parks Department as compared to the same period last year. When we start counting water now for future years, we'll probably see some changes in our graphs to reflect the fact that the big pool will now be operated by the city. So I would anticipate in future reports you're going to see a jump on city water consumption. We'll continue to kind of keep the big pool separated out so we know where that is from year to year. But that on in terms of the city's side of things, we'll be adding the amount of water that gets used at that pool to the city's tally, not to the rec commission that come off of their tally. As we noted in prior years, and there's a graph below that in demonstrating the water consumption as a whole and what departments are responsible, the Garden City Recreation Commission, Lee Richardson Zoo, and Parks are the largest users of non-revenue water in the city. Those three departments account for 82% of all non-revenue water consumption, and the Utilities Department and the Cemetery account for 17% of water usage. And the remaining 1% is attributed to all the remaining departments within the city. And that chart below illustrates that usage. Overall, for city water consumption year to date, we're on pace to match our consumption in 2015. The consumption so far this year is about 7 million gallons less than the same period last year, which is negligible. Frankly, these last few days we're having with 90 degree temperatures probably will make up that difference if it continues much longer. We continue to see a small growth trend in water consumption during the first months of the year when most water consumption is limited to households. January numbers, if you look at that chart there, have increased steadily over the past 5 years. And so we're going to continue watching that. That would indicate to us that we may be visiting with the commission at some point in the future about ways to promote more efficient use of water within the household.
Are we confident in those meters? I mean, do we have some metering issues?
Yeah, those meters,
Five years old
or less, and we are installing a number of it'd be similar to a magnetic meter where there's no mechanicals in them at all. So metering, if anything, is becoming more accurate, but I wouldn't say that meter accuracy is what's contributing to the change in consumption. I think we just frankly have more meters out there than we did a few years ago.
Some of that would be growth.
It's growth, yeah.
It's not people being wasteful necessarily.
No. And so, you know, might give us cause to think about how we can promote conservation to offset some of the impacts of growth within the community. Those numbers compared to January 2016, 7.2% higher water consumption than in the same month in 2012. We also saw a jump from February 2016 as compared to 2012 as well. So some fairly good jumps in winter water usage. The last chart shows city water consumption by month from 2012 to 2016, and we can see that obviously, the milder summer that we had this year had a significant impact on our water usage. Water consumption over the summer months of 2016 very closely resembled last summer, and consumption year to date is about 365 million gallons less than it was in the same period during 2012. So that's it's probably 1,000 acre feet of water and then some and reduced water usage with the good fortune of being out of an extremely hot summer and a drought. Commission, have any questions?
Thank you.
Mayor and Commissioners, item 7B, Communication and Project Manager Freeberg will provide an update on the city's website redesign.
There's a services for the city of Garden City. One of the first steps that Vision took was to do some surveys of the community to learn about the usability of our site. I meant to improve usability of the new site. I can click through, Matt, you don't need to.
No, good.
And
improve the quality of this.
Presentation.
And so after the ways that they did that were with a community survey that we put out on our website, we put out on social media, news release about just to try and get some information from the community. They also did a stakeholder survey, and that stakeholder committee is basically a committee that's made up of individuals from lots of different city departments. And then they also looked at our analytics for our current website, and then they did a heat mapping on our website. And then they put all of that together into this presentation. This is actually a presentation that Vision put together. I can't take responsibility for it. And our committee really liked it, so we thought that it was information that maybe you would be interested in as well. So with the stakeholder survey, they asked us what our top goals were with the website, and from that we came up with the quality of the execution, the ease in maintaining the content, and the creation of an information portal. There are a couple other options for us to choose from. One of them was how quickly they could get it done. We chose the quality of the execution over the quickly, the pace at which it's accomplished. They also asked what we thought the purpose of our website is. What do we think people are going to our website for? We think they're going there to pay their bills, to apply for jobs. We think they would like to go there for park reservations. That's not a functionality of our current website. For service requests and for information on special events. We also talked about a lot of the things that we like about our current website. The fact that it houses a ton of information. A lot of that's found in the document center. We do allow for online bill payment with utility bills. We like photos, we like that it's used as a landing point to start community conversations, and we also really like the Google Translate feature, given that there are so many languages spoken in our community. And then we spent a little bit of time talking about the things that we don't like with our current website. I don't really want to dwell on those too much. They're all listed there, though. One of the main things, or a couple of the main things, that I will touch on are the fact that there are a lot of things on our current website that aren't customizable. We can't go in and make changes. We have to contact our current vendor to have them make the changes, and usually that comes at a cost for us. And we also don't like the fact that we can't have customizable URLs. So if we wanted to send somebody to our website to look at our financial profile, it's www.garden-city.org/?AID, you know, just lots of different numbers and letters. Whereas with our new site, we'll be able to go /financial profile. So it's right there, easy to find. And then they also asked us, what are the things that people are calling into your organization to ask about? Maybe we can eliminate some of those phone calls by making that information more present on your website. So again, long list, you can look through that at your leisure. And then they did the community survey. The community survey was open from June 25th to July 7th. They had hoped to get a sample size of 379 responses. We ended up with 233, which was still a pretty good response for our community. And this is the part that we were most interested in. They asked, how do you identify as a website user? Most of the users identified as a resident of Garden City. A lot of them you can see also work in Garden City. They're customers, program participants, business owners, lots of different things there. Average age of our website users, I don't think that this is probably too surprising to anybody. The largest age group was 25 to 34, which is where demographically that's where our average population falls. Second to that was 55 to 64 years old, so you can see that technology is being adopted by all age groups, not just the younger generations, and everything in between that. We also asked how often people visit the website, and it looks like for the majority of users, they're visiting our website only when they're looking for something, which again wasn't too surprising to our committee. What was a little surprising was we knew that smartphones were used a lot to access our site. I don't think we realized quite how much. They're tied at almost 70% with a traditional computer for people who are accessing. So one of the things that we're looking at with this redesign is a mobile presence that's more user-friendly, that's more aesthetically appealing, and I think that we're gonna be really pleased with how that turns out. They were also asked how they usually find the city's website. Most people go to a search engine such as Google or Yahoo to search Garden City, Kansas, rather than typing in www.garden-city.org. And then they created these word clouds for the open-ended questions. What are your reasons for visiting the city of Garden City's website? And the bigger the word is, the more that came up. So a lot of people are looking for information on their departments, for contact information, for phone numbers, for events. And one thing that was really interesting to us is that Vision pointed out that we didn't have a contact us phone number anywhere on our homepage. So people were having to go to our staff directory or look at department pages, and that's something, we've had this website for 5 years, and that's something that was never printed out to us before. So, generally, people didn't find it too difficult to find stuff on our website, moderately easy. However, we're also looking at the middle option. When you have a set of five, people tend to choose the middle option. So they told us to look at the biggest percentage outside of the middle option, so people generally found it easy to find stuff on our website, which is not the feedback that we had gotten in personal conversations. So then they're asked to explain a time when they had a difficult time finding what they were looking for. Again, departments, contact, phone number, events are all among some of the biggest items. So if you go back to the what are you looking for most often, it's the same things that they're having difficulty finding. And then list the pages that you find most useful, contact, departments, zoos, pretty big, city commission, utilities, codes, and calendar. What people like, what the general population likes about our website tends to be the same thing that the city staff survey likes about our population. They like the way it looks, they like the pictures, they like how colorful it is. But those aren't necessarily very they're not related to the usability at all. What can be improved on the city's website? Right there at the top, we have user-friendly, pictures, citizen, navigation. Those are the sorts of things that we're trying to address. Then we have a list of what based on our analytics, what the most requested pages are, what people are looking for most often. And then the final slide that I have regards heat maps. And the way the heat maps were done is they installed some code on our website that tracked where our mouse hovers, because when you're using a traditional computer, a lot of times when you're reading something or when you're looking for something, you'll use your mouse, and that tracks where your eyes go on the screen. And so they identified what the hotspots were, and that's what this slide shows. So typically people are looking along that, they call it an F pattern, the stuff down the side, and then a couple of rows across, that's where they're spending the most time on our website. And then down at the bottom, you can see that contact us button is getting hit a lot. So that was just a brief update on that very first step, all of the research phase. Right now we're in the design page. We've identified the order that we want the content to be in, but we're working on graphic design, what exactly that's gonna look like. After this phase, we'll have content development. And that's going to be what takes the longest. That's where we're going to decide exactly where the different content needs to go on the site, how things are going to be grouped together. That'll also include the content migration, taking stuff from the old site, making sure it's all updated before we insert it into the new site. And then we'll have a soft launch where city staff, maybe a few other stakeholders have access to the site, can go in and find the bugs to help us fix them before our launch, which we anticipate to be late winter or early spring, probably sometime between February and April. Do you have any questions on the website?
Looks good.
All
right,
thank you.
Item seven. Here.
Sorry, meeting's been out.
Yeah. All right, thanks. items 7C through 7I are other staff reports that have been included in this packet. If you have any questions on those, I think most of that staff is present. Would like to point out that congratulations to Christy and her staff for the accreditation of the zoo again through the AZA, and several folks were a part of that review process earlier this year. And so it was nice to get that notification. Not a surprise, but we shouldn't take it for granted either. So I believe there's a little over 200 accredited zoos in the country. Is that correct? So that's a real badge of honor for this community to meet that standard. Not hearing any additional questions. I know 8 is the meetings of note. We'll point out that the breakfast for the annual State of the City address is October 19th, not October 18th. That'll be a breakfast out at the golf club at Southwind at 7:30 a.m. Now we're ready for item 9A, which is the appropriation ordinance. If it's approved, it'll be appropriation ordinance number 2419-2016.
I'll make a motion to approve the appropriation ordinance number 2419-2016.
I'll second.
A motion and a second to approve appropriation ordinance number 2419-2016. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor, aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed?
10A, the governing body is asked to consider and approve an amendment to City of Garden City Code section number 94-2A, vegetation related to arborist license. Andy?
Mayor, commissioners, good afternoon. Right now what we're looking at is the code or the ordinance requires anyone who wants to spray pesticides on trees in the city to have an arborist license. And the two fields aren't necessarily related in that way. So a company that wanted to come in and spray trees would technically have to go through the arborist exam and prove that they can cut and all of this stuff in order to identify pests and to spray. Well, the Kansas Department of Agriculture already has requirements that an applicator has to adhere to and obtain in order to spray, and so they've already paid their dues, so to speak, in order to be qualified by the state to spray. And currently we don't have anybody coming in pesticide applicator licenses asking to apply for an arborist license. And also in this license, we've also taken the opportunity in this ordinance to make a distinction of what requires an arborist license as far as cutting requirements versus what can a landscaper do. And right now there's an 8-foot ordinance over sidewalks that limbs have to be up, and we think that's the appropriate height to say a landscaper, a landscape maintenance guy who's taking care of a yard can cut up to 8 feet. Anything above that to protect the industry, to protect the homeowners from limbs falling on houses, we think 8 feet is the limit where that dividing line is, where an arborist license should be obtained.
Okay. If the commission, if there's a motion to adopt, it would be appropriate to move approval of ordinance number 2739-2016, which is an ordinance removing the requirement to obtain a City of Garden City, Kansas issued arborist license to apply pesticides to trees, prune trees, plant trees, and trim trees and shrubs, and amends the code section 94-2.
I move that we approve ordinance number 2739-2016.
I'll second.
We have a motion and a second to approve ordinance number 2739-2016, removing the requirement to obtain an issued arborist license under certain circumstances. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
Item 10B, the governing body is asked to consider and approve adding code section 94-5, vegetation. This is dealing with hazardous trees on private property. Andy?
We currently have an ordinance that allows us to approach a homeowner, property owner, with a letter that in 30 days, if we deem a tree hazardous to life, property, or insect infestations to other trees, those kind of things, the homeowner has 30 days. However, we come across trees every once in a while that, you know, you may walk up to it and you hear the wind blowing and it's creaking. And some of those, it doesn't happen very often, some of those need to be taken down right away. And what this ordinance is asking is that we could approach the homeowner with a letter in person and request within 36 hours that that tree come down. It's not trying to step into stuff, it's more protection. And we don't have very many of them, but we just want to be able to have the ability to go after those if it's necessary. And we just have a couple of those every year. And so that would come at the discretion of the superintendent of the public grounds or whoever the city manager would appoint in that position.
How does that affect an individual who's got 36 hours and can't get a professional to come in and take that down?
We would be responsible to come in and take it down at that point. Okay. And then we would bill them according to its. We have that all written out when we do code enforcement and other things like that along those hours that's already in the ordinances. Another thing that you might have a question on, what happened if we can't get a hold of the homeowner and the tree needs to come down? Well, if we go in and take that out, the ordinance is written as such, and if we can't get a hold of them and we take it out, then we can't charge them to take it out, I believe is how the ordinance is written. Is that correct?
Yes. And maybe the whole tree, maybe just one branch or whatever would be necessary to make it
safe.
Just because one big branch might be.
Right.
It just doesn't mean necessarily the whole tree. So it would be the minimum amount necessary to return it to a safe state, I guess. And bill against the property, and if the property didn't pay, would move on to
city clerk,
for collection or something like that.
And if the commission's interested in adopting this ordinance, the appropriate motion would be the approval of ordinance number 2740-2016, an ordinance allowing the city of Garden City to remove imminently hazardous trees from private property when posing an immediate threat to life or property.
I move we approve ordinance 2740-2016.
I'll second.
And hopefully, most of the time, you would be able to see a tree before it gets to this stage.
Maybe. It may be a neighbor that files a complaint that says, hey, this is, because, we can drive around and see lots of trees in the back of people's yards that need to come out. Mm-hmm. But as far as one that we think has to come out right now or something, a lot of that'll be a complaint, or we do it in parks sometimes, like, hey, this one, just go, stop what we're doing or take it out. Mm-hmm. And so some of it would be complaint based.
Okay.
So we have a motion and a second to approve ordinance number 2740-2016. Allowing the city to remove imminently hazardous trees from private property. Is there any further discussion? And so I would emphasize the private property. And if it was out, what about that island between the sidewalk and the curb? That's those trees.
The city right-of-way?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. When that's the right-of-way.
In a nutshell, we have the ability to go into those and do what we want to do.
Another point is, we may receive a complaint or however we come across it, keeping in mind it's the property owner's responsibility to kind of keep up with their trees and not allow them to get to that point too. But you get a windstorm and a tree that was fine is now a problem. And so, it's just the nature of a city with the Tree City USA, I guess.
Yeah.
And that's just one of those things that we want the trees, but there are a few of these times. Everybody needs to be in a position to do whatever is the safest thing.
Yeah. We're not just talking about a dead tree that we want. We're talking about something that now has to come out. Mm-hmm. Something that's probably been dead.
And I would say a windstorm is your most likely thing to come along in general, because that's happened in the past after some pretty good windstorms in Garden City. We've had a lot of ones that came down and then some that you could tell that they were coming down soon. Mm-hmm.
Not a lot of issues, just every once in a while,
right,
throughout the years, something like that.
Yeah.
And really, it's for the safety of the community and the property.
property owner, and so, but not a lot of
right
ones throughout the year.
Yeah, we're not driving through the city right looking for things to take down.
Sure.
It's when we come across and we have to look.
Any further discussion? All those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Thank you, Andy.
Item 10C, the governing body is asked to consider and approve the vacation of an alley adjacent to lots 13, 14, 15, 19, 20, 21, and 22, subdivision of block 37, original plat in Garden City. Carol?
Matt, can you scroll down to the map? It's easier to explain it this way. I've got my pointer. Okay, basically what this is, Fulton's here, and downtown area, Main Street's here, and then 7th Street's here. The owner of this of L&L Floor Coverings, Larry Funk, he owns this property, and he owns all of these lots here. This is all the 13, 14, 19, 20, 21, and 22. He's asking that the city vacate, or requesting that the city vacate this little portion right here, which was created when these lots were turned in the opposite direction of all the other ones for access for these lots. But he owns all of these, and he does not plan on developing them the way that they're platted right now. So he's requesting an easement of that. This represents all the utilities. So there isn't any utilities that run in that access easement there. It's a 10 by 140-foot easement that he's requesting be vacated. You have the option to grant the vacation of this easement or not to grant it. Staff recommends to grant it because it does not serve a purpose right now for the public at large. And if you have any questions.
If approved, this would be ordinance number 2741, vacating an alley at the described location.
Make the motion we approve ordinance 2741-2016.
Second.
Motion and a second to approve ordinance number 2741-2016, vacating alley between the described lots, block 37, original plat of the city. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor, aye.
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 Opposed?
Item 11A, the governing body is asked to consider and approve the use of the excess law enforcement center sales tax funds for three additional projects. Jennifer?
Good afternoon, Mayor and Commissioners. This issue was before you July 19th of 2016, and I'm sure you didn't expect to see me this soon. However, there have been three additional projects that the county has introduced. Those three projects were brought forward, and they were actually confirmed by Chief Utes. I've looked at the projects, and also Cheryl Carroll from the county. The three projects include air conditioning for the server room and dispatch and records, which they're like a closed-in closet server room, so there's a lot of electronics in there. There's no windows, so they need to put in units that will cool those areas to keep that equipment safe, and they need two of those, and those run about $5,000. So you're looking at a total of $10,000. The next one is stair treads and landings in the LEC. If you've been in there, they're concrete stairs that are covered with a rubber type material, and they're getting to the point that it's actually a safety hazard and something that needs to be addressed as soon as possible. And that cost is $25,064.97. The last thing in the additional projects is a water filter for the LEC at a cost of $3,900. So what does this mean, I guess, in the overall picture is that this is $38,965. We only have $39,477. So it's about $512. That's not a lot for overages with all of the other projects we have going on. The benefit, one benefit we do have is that the city projects, the ones that are going on in the law enforcement center, the kitchenette, and then municipal court, and also the investigation cubicles. Those projects combined are going to come in at a savings of about $4,500. So yay that there's a little extra money there, but when you look at the overall budget, it's only about a 1% of the overall in progress projects. So after presenting this to the city manager and the county administrator, the thought was this needs to go before both commissions so that they can look at this and make a decision. I was in front of the county commission yesterday and explained this, and I think really what this means is not that these three projects aren't important and need to get done. I believe they are, and that's my recommendation in the end of this memo. But what this does mean is that the projects are gonna become a first come, first serve basis. You get in, you get your project done. If it's important, you need to get it done now. You need to get the bids in, select somebody, and move forward. And there's probably going to come a point in time that there's some project at the end of this that may or may not get done if it didn't get done quickly enough. So that's the other reason that I included all of the projects and where they are to date, so you can kind of get a picture for how things are moving. But at this point in time, what I'm asking is that you either approve the three additional projects, leaving everything else the same, deny the three additional projects, approve one or more of them, or give me another suggestion. And the county approved alternative number one, which was my suggestion.
Jim, for the big, if memory serves me correctly, the biggest sticker item on here was the rooftop units. Is that right?
The HVAC.
The largest one?
Yeah, cost wise.
The one that was removed?
No. The second bullet. RFPs for the rooftop units.
Yes, that was a fairly large, not large number, although that
one. So that's the last project to get done, and it's subject to volatility in pricing and contractor availability. That's a county project. That was one of them
right.
They identified.
Initially.
If the funds are used up and that one runs high, is it, will there be an expectation on the county's part? Did they discuss that would be a shared cost, or they understand that if that runs over?
The discussion yesterday was that if the money's gone and the project's not done, the discussion was that, at this point, the discussion initially with this was that we wanted projects to move forward. We wanted to go ahead and get these funds done and close this and be finished with this agreement that had been going on for a couple of years. And so we wanted the projects to move anyways. And this is just kind of, I guess, putting a more hard-pressed deadline on everybody to get their numbers in and try and get them in on the bids and not going over or not having issues. If they do, if we don't have a lot of overages, we should be fine with all the projects that are out there as we've calculated. But I just wanted everyone to understand in this that if we go ahead and move forward and the stair treads and landings get finished tomorrow and all the other projects kind of follow along and there ends up being a project at the end that has some major overage, that's going to have to come from somewhere. And it's not going to be this account.
Well, I think the policy question maybe for the two commissions is there's leftover projects unfinished and it's a city project. Is the city expecting if these funds aren't there that there's a sharing of the cost with the county, or does the county commission feel that if their project isn't done, is there a sharing of that cost then with the,
sure.
The city, or is it part of the answer to the first question is knowing what happens on the backside. I think the strategy of first in, first out meets the primary objective to get it done. Sales tax has been
expired. But these were leftover funds anyway, right? These were these were leftover funds anyway, and we're trying to.
We created a wish list.
Yeah, and we're trying to finish some projects, or these are some of the maintenance issues because of the longevity of the building.
And if you look at the list,
trying
too.
To update some of the areas and stuff.
Exactly.
If I remember correctly.
Yeah. And I think the things that have become important, I mean, the two of the things that have no updates, the detention door lock retrofit and the CCTV storage were wish list items that the county put on, but there's been no movement in those. And so, things that haven't moved at all, maybe those can be identified down the road as, hey, these were wish list items, but they didn't become as important, or, we didn't end up needing to do those as much as we needed to do the stair treads and landings. And I think there may be another conversation that we're having, in 2 months or 3 months as these funds as we continually update the commissions, the city manager, county administrator, and keep looking at where these funds are going, we may have another conversation about the funds that are left or the remaining projects that are left. But at this point, this is where we're at.
The rooftop units and main courtroom units, those are air conditioning units?
Correct.
And those are expensive?
They are expensive.
So is that, has there been an amount that's kind of being held back for this, or?
So all of the stuff that's on this list has an amount that's being held for. It has an amount that was budgeted based on a bid or based on an estimation by someone who looked at it or by a maintenance person. There's an amount being held for each project that's on this list. It's just a matter of, has it actually been out for bid, and has that bid come in, and has that bid been accepted? So the money for each is set aside, and the 4,000 is the amount that right now we're looking at. With those set amounts in there, would be left over.
I think that as you go into that, if there's $100,000 say set back for these rooftop units, and the bid comes in at 109, then the county moves forward based on coming up with another $9,000, or maybe having to, and any overage past that should, you know, come up during the project, and still getting the, you know, a pretty good start on it. Same with any city project. I mean, wouldn't we, if darn it, it went $500 over and there's no money left, wouldn't we say, well, we can find $500, let's go ahead and get this done? So, I mean,
you're absolutely
at some
right.
point in time, I think you have the choice. If you're not already started on the project, you have the choice of starting it knowing that, you know, we're just going to have to find a few more dollars. But it's, I don't see it becoming, I mean, you're still getting the biggest part of it paid for out of this excess fund.
Exactly.
Excess funds fund.
And we did have one of our city projects that was over by about $1,300, but then the other two city projects came in significantly under where we thought they were going to be. So we were able to, with the funds we had allotted originally, do those three projects and then also leave some behind after getting those set. So
I don't know what the county commission came up with, but I would want our decision, I think, to include the fact that, you know, their projects are theirs and ours are ours. And, you know, no expectation of sharing the lack of money at the end or overages or anything like that.
Basically, what you're saying is the initial wish list has already been funded, and you had $39,000 left over, and we have another wish list here. If we don't use it, someone else will.
Well, as the
most likely.
As the amount was left before, this commission decided that we would come back at the end, and whatever was left over, then we would decide what to do with that money. And basically what I'm saying today is something's come up, and it's an issue, and we need to address it. And
county has found a use for those
excess funds. Exactly. And I will say the stair treads and the landings are in very poor condition, and that's a facility, you know, that's an area that's used by both the city and the county. And although the county came up with that project through their maintenance, I would consider that a city project just as much as that's a county project. You know, Chief Hughes can probably, if he's here, speak to how poor they are, maybe give some information on that. And being in IT previously, I can tell you those rooms, absolutely, their air conditioners went out, and they absolutely have to have those. We won't last 6 months without an air conditioner in those rooms.
I'll make a motion that we approve the three additional projects.
Second.
Everything else the same.
We have a motion and a second to approve the additional three projects in the use of the excess law enforcement center sales tax funds. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Item 12A, the governing body is asked to consider and approve selling 1904 Crestway through a sealed bid process. Jennifer?
Commissioners, Mayor, good afternoon. On July 27th of 2016, there was a journal entry of default judgment quieting title in the property at 1904 Crestway to the City of Garden City. This quiet title plus the quitclaim deed from Bank of America provides the requisite ownership interest for the city to sell the property and for First American Title underwrite owner's title insurance on the property. This has been something that myself and Caleb and Randy, Matt, that we've all been discussing kind of how this procedure should look, and I'm here today to give you what we've come up with and ask for your approval of that process. Up to date, the expenses in this property have included attorney's fees of $2,000, demolition of the structure that had caught fire for $37,260, taxes in the amount of $703.47, mowing and maintenance of the grounds, $1,000, and administrative and notices of $732.98 for a total of $41,696.45. That is to date. Now, there will still be additional expenses for attorney's fees to close the sale of the property and any other things that have to be done in order to get the transfer taken. Attached to the memo, you'll find a map of the property, its location. It's a 1.3 acre lot, and it's previously appraised for $29,950. We're asking at this time that you proceed with a sealed bid process, that it officially be in today. Bids would need to be hand delivered to Deering and Grizzell, and they would need to, which is at 124 Grant Street in Garden City. Each bidder would be given a receipt to confirm their submission, and they'd be accepted until October 27th at 1 o'clock p.m. In order for a bid to be complete, it must be $50,000 or more, provide a time for closing, include any information that they want the commission to know that they feel is pertinent to their bid, and include their name, address, and best way to be contacted. Additionally, by submitting a bid, the bidder would be agreeing to pay cash at the time of closing and provide $1,000 in earnest money upon signing the purchase agreement. City Attorney Grizzell and Assistant City Attorney Cunningham would review the bids and provide all of the offers to myself by 5 p.m. on October 31st of 2016. I would then provide those bids to you at the regular scheduled meeting on November 1st of 2016. You do not have an obligation through this process to accept the highest bid. You can accept any of the bids that are brought to you, but they will not be, basically the sealed bid process, what this means is they'll turn them into Randy, and Randy will keep them in a stack until the day that him and his assistant review them, then they'll go through and review each one, make sure they're complete, make sure that they met the process, and then turn them over to us, only the ones that are complete at that point. So you can approve this process, you can tweak this process, you can give another suggestion for it, and we're just recommending, since we obviously put it together, we're recommending alternative one.
So I guess if somebody comes in with a bid of a dollar, that's going to be put in one pile compared to what you're saying here, the offer has to be at least $50,000 or more.
Mm-hmm. Yep, it wouldn't meet the requirements of the bid process.
Okay.
How would you advertise this?
Oh, I'm sorry, I should have mentioned that. So after today, in addition to giving notice at this meeting, Randy will be putting a sign in the yard that states that the property is for sale. He's also going to do a notice in the Garden City Telegram.
We have a list of, I would say, maybe not quite a dozen, but maybe as many as 10 people, 8 to 10 people.
Correct.
Who have asked to be notified when we got to the point where we were ready to move the property. So, certainly word of mouth out there. We gave a heads up to the Builders Association on Thursday that this item would be on today's City Commission agenda if any of that group was interested. We know that a couple people in the room were on the list that wanted notified, so we figured there may be some additional interest in that room.
I move that we approve selling of 1904 Crestway through a sealed bid process.
With a minimum.
As described. Yeah.
Second.
I have a motion, a second, to approve selling 1904 Crestway through the sealed bid process as described in the memo. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor, aye.
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 Opposed?
Thanks, Jennifer. Item 12B, the governing body is asked to consider and approve the addendum to the development agreement of the Ranch House Addition. Carol?
Good afternoon again. This addendum to the development agreement, basically what it is all about, the Ranch House development is going through the site plan process right now, and they had planned on having two entrances into their development, one from off of campus and one off of Trailblazer, which is
within the Pioneer Road Estates subdivision. Through stormwater or drainage issues, they decided that it would be more advantageous not to put in the entrance off of Trailblazer. So at this time, they want to just keep one entrance in off of campus. However, this addendum addresses the need for an additional entrance into their development, which they've opted to add a second entrance off of campus a little bit further north, a little bit closer to Pioneer Road Estates. And when they do that, that'll ease the drainage issues that they are finding on this property. And so this is what the addendum mentions. The addendum was written up by Randy, and it details that the city will agree to have a second entrance off of campus, and that both entrances that we're planning on going into Pioneer Road Estates will not go in. And they are given 3 years to put that in from the date of the acceptance of this addendum. So your option is to approve it as presented, which is in your packet, approve it with some amendments to it, or not approve it at all.
Did they know, like, what kind of traffic that's going to generate? Are we going to need a turning lane, or, I mean, an extra lane as more businesses?
Well, they have, I believe, right now they're just doing a smaller section. As it progresses, we'll know a little bit more. I believe it's 212 rooms right now. It might be a little bit bigger. I'm not quite sure on those exact numbers. But for right now, no, everything is good on campus the way it is.
Campus Drive in that section already already has it's a three-lane configuration with a chicken lane in the in the middle, which is adequate for whatever they would do. It's certainly adequate for what they're doing in phase one, and it's likely adequate for whatever they do in phase two, although we don't know what all that may entail at this point.
Yes. They have given us a preliminary plan, but they're not bound to stick with that, so it could change up, and we'll kind of go with it, identify the areas that need to be addressed as they come up.
Isn't that area in the front going to remain, what, just landscape area?
Well, actually, that area is where they wanted to put in patio homes. So it, as I said, we're not sure exactly how many they'd like to put in. That's, I believe, the final stage, so it might be one.
That lot has a lot of slope to it.
It does, it does.
So
and
the water is going to end up at the bottom of the hill.
Well, we do have a drainage plan, and they have been working with our engineers on that, on getting that approved, and I believe we have come to a consensus on that, so that the drainage will go where it needs to go and not damage anyone's property.
Yeah, I'll make a motion. We approve the amendment, addendum, I guess, to the developer's agreement for the ranch house addition.
Second.
I have a motion and a second to approve the addendum to the development agreement of the ranch house addition. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Item 12C, the governing body is asked to consider and appoint a board member to fill the unexpired term left by Alyssa Benavidez on the Garden City Recreation Commission Board. Jennifer?
Hey. Yeah.
Well, you're up there.
Good afternoon again. The Garden City Recreation Commission is governed by a five-member board. The four that are currently still on the board after the current resignation include Micah Bunch, Jamie Warren, Marilyn Porter, and Deborah Euler. Deborah was just recently added at the last application process, and you considered her application along with Jacob Olinger and Keith Rathbun. That was on May 17th of 2016. At this point in time, you still have those two applicants. You wanted to keep them on file in case this happened again, so we brought them up. We brought them forward, and then we have the two new additions, which is Stephanie Cahill and Patricia Allen. So before you is to appoint one of these four individuals or deny all are for. And at this point, obviously staff has no recommendation, but I would open the floor to if any of the applicants are here and would like to speak, and then also if there's anyone else who wants to speak on the issue. Any of the applicants present? So
okay.
We'll let this applicant speak, and then if anyone else wants to.
Good afternoon, Mayor and Commissioners. I have some interest in being on this board.
And you are?
My name is Keith Rathbun.
Okay.
I've been here, lived here for 7 years. I'm sorry.
That's okay.
I have had some interest in this. One, I have two boys. One is two, one is seven. And just developing just what sports bring to a community. We have a growing one. And I think I bring a lot to that table within the sports knowledge. I went to University of Kansas and played football there for a year. I walked on there. I ended up finishing at Fort Hays and got my degree in MIS, which is Management Information Systems. So IT is my background. As I mentioned, I've been here about 7 years. Originally grew up in Great Bend, so that's Western Kansas to me. Everybody in Great Bend in that area, but like I said, this is our home, and so I really would like to develop these programs and be a part of that, rather than just talk about what they're not doing and be a part of what we can do to help make that better. So I would just ask for that consideration to assist on the board. Questions for me, or?
I don't think so. Thank you.
Thank you.
No problem.
Is there any other of the candidates?
Aaron or Micah?
Good afternoon. I've read through the profiles that were submitted, and obviously we want people that are progressive minded with leadership qualities. It's unfortunate we can't hear from all of them, but this really resides in your hands. Please select somebody that's a leader that can bring some attributes to help us go forward and give positive direction. Any questions for me?
So we need one.
Yes,
just one.
Actually, there is a way to hear all four. We could consider at our next pre-meeting having the four come and letting each that want to speak and present theirs, as Mr. Rathbun has. If there's any interest in that, four is a bunch, and a couple of Mr. Rathbun being one that didn't know or had never heard of, so that would be one way to help narrow this down, maybe, and then we could, at the meeting, following the pre-meeting, we could do our decision.
But this is filling a position, a vacated position, right away.
Right, it is. So
resigning from that position.
Yeah, correct. So they will fulfill the term, which is, I believe, I want to say just over 2 years remaining. And then, obviously, upon that point, there would be a reappointment.
And we have two that are kind of have been on file here. So I'll make a motion that we approve Keith Rathbun for the vacant position on the Garden City Rec Board.
I'll second that.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve Keith Rathbun to fill the unexpired term on the Rec Commission Board. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor, aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Aye. All right, motion passes. And my proposal is not you, Mr. Rathbun. I was wanting to maybe hear from everybody before I made my decision.
Sure, absolutely.
That we're ready for item 12D. This is the consent agenda. There's no changes, so if you keep the list, it would be D1 through
agenda, approval of D1 through 9.
I'll second.
Who's got it?
Fifth Commissioner Fancas.
I think that takes you the tally, whatever this time.
Whatever, that's a word.
We have a motion and a second to approve the consent agenda as provided. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
That concludes the business items. Mayor, I think we're ready for item 13, Commissioner reports.
Okay, Commissioner Dale?
Yes, I want to thank Ashley and Jennifer for the good presentation they did at 11 o'clock in our pre-meeting. I know there's a lot of work that went into that, and there's a lot of thinking outside the box sometimes coming up with exactly the right wording, and so I want to thank you both for that. I want to thank Lee Richardson Zoo for their accreditation as Association of the Zoos and Aquarium. Again, that's another time, but it just goes to show that we've got good leadership for many years, and you're filling them shoes just quite well, waiting in there. The Oktoberfest was a great time downtown this weekend. It was, I was surprised, it's probably been a number of years since I've been there. I was surprised at the number of booths that were there providing either food or entertainment, what have you, all the way up and down Main Street, but I was, the number of people that showed up amazed me. It was well turned out. I thought it was a great show. The mayor was responsible for good, cool weather, so we owe him a word of thanks there. The street department did a good job of getting the barricades up to keep people from safe and there are no traffic. Electrical department did a great job of running all that electrical down Main Street to supply the power for all the people that needed. And of course, all the others that either volunteered or were city staff, we thank you. That's all I have.
Mr. Dole?
I enjoyed the pre-meeting this morning as we worked through our legislative policy for the state and federal levels. I think it's going to be a great one. And then I also want to congratulate all of the zoo employees, along with Christy, for their ACA accreditation. So, that's all I have.
Commissioner Fancas.
I'd just like to also comment on the website. I think that's going to be quite an improvement, and I appreciate the work put in on that, and hopefully everyone will use it more, and it's easier to understand. So that's going to be exciting. The zoo, thank you for your help in getting the accreditation, and that's all I have.
Mr. Sussman.
I'll just kind of say ditto to the remarks that the other commissioners noted. Couldn't make it to the presentation on the water nozzle display, but that's kind of working towards our goals of hopefully saving and conserving water in the community. And I'd like to thank Fred for his report today on updating us on the water consumption that we have in the community here, and hopefully we'll keep working towards saving and conserving the water that we do have, which is a precious resource. I'd like to thank the Garden City Police Department on their response to the issue that was, or potential issue that we had at Garden City High School. It was great to see the partnership on the safety of our students and, you know, the additional officers that were present that day. I know it kind of took out of their activities, but it's great to see that, you know, we do have law enforcement that does partner and help with our school district here in the community, and you know, safety of our students is a top priority in our community. So I'd like to thank not only the chief, but all the officers that helped out that day. So thank you very much. That's all I've got.
Well, I'll start by congratulating the zoo and Christy, and all the staff over there. I suppose those of you that have been mayor have gotten to, well, no, it's been, how often does that happen? Every five. So maybe none of you guys had to. I got to do it this year. As far as just talk to the people, I mean, I wasn't certainly involved in the biggest part of it. But so I got a report, and you would only have to look at this report, 100, 300 and some lines of rating, and got, I think there was 7 Qs, which is questionable, and that's not as bad as it sounds, because there was some of them that we met what the requirement was, but they still had a Q out there to the side, so I don't quite understand that. But at any rate, that's a very involved project, and a lot of hard work goes into preparing for it, and then executing it on the, not only zoo staff, but other city staff, I think, too. So when I got this in the mail and reviewed it, I was impressed by, that impressed upon me, I guess, what goes into that. So I can assure you that the zoo is working hard and impressing some people that don't impress easy. They are zoo people themselves, and so that's a big deal. So appreciate the policy pre-meeting. Staff is balancing, I think, really 4 different policy sets there: city, federal, and state. That's 2. The Southwest Kansas Coalition, and then the League of Kansas Municipalities, and trying to make sure that where we're at on all of those, that we're not in conflict, and how do they come together and how do they work together. So as welcome on both counts, and
mayor,
you guys said I should take credit, I didn't. But I'll echo, I think, Commissioner Dale. I was wild at the number of people, vendors, and that kind of thing. Too deep most of the way, or too wide going down Main Street, and the choices for food, that's not a good thing. it's a great thing. So then one of you mentioned, I think Commissioner Dale again, the city staff, the investment by city staff at a parade or a downtown event or any of some of these events around town is incredible. Those people come to work on a Saturday, and they do it with very happily, I think. I mean, when we go by in the parade, those guys are waving, they're friendly, and, so that's a big deal. It's a big investment by the city, dollar-wise, but it's also a big investment by our staff. And another sign about the quality of our staff, I think they enjoy the fact that we do those, even though they have to work at it, rather than kind of be there just to enjoy it. So that's a big deal to put together all that for a parade or a festival or whatever, but one that's important for the community, I think. So with that, I think that's all I have, and so we'll